Good morning. Good to see all of y'all here today. Thank you for choosing to worship with us here at New Home today. Did y'all have a good Christmas? Lord was good to us, amen? Still is. I always count on Joe to correct me. In a good way. Y'all kind of balance each other out, good and bad right there. I'm just going to leave that one hanging. Thank you for coming today to worship with us. I would invite you, our scripture today is coming from the Gospel of Matthew. So if you would, take your Bibles or one of the Bibles from the pew racks in front of you. Today we're going to be looking in the second chapter of Matthew. I will be reading a few verses from the second chapter of Matthew. Matthew chapter 2, I will be beginning in verse 13. And when they had departed, behold, the angel of the Lord appeareth to Joseph in a dream, saying, Arise, and take the young child and his mother, and flee into Egypt, and be thou there until I bring thee word, for Herod will seek the young child to destroy him. When he arose, he took the young child and his mother by night and departed into Egypt, and was there until the death of Herod, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken of the Lord by the prophet, saying, Out of Egypt have I called my son. Would you pray with me? Father God, Lord, as we gather today, may we be grateful. Lord, for a wonderful Christmas time. Lord, for the blessing of just being able to come here today to worship and to glorify you. May we lift up from the depths of our hearts an eternal gratitude for all that you have done for us and all that you will do for us. We pray, dear God, that you would come now and be a part of our service. I pray that you would push me away and that you would speak your words for your people from this pulpit. Help us today, dear Lord. We have come here today because we need you. We pray today, dear God, that you would reveal your word, your will, and your way unto us. Help us to listen, dear Lord, then help us to go and do. In your Son's name we pray. Amen. All right, I'm going to let y'all in on a little bit of little secret this morning. I'm going to tell you how I write a sermon. Most of the time when I write a sermon, I start out with a story. Something will happen, God will give me an illustration or call my attention to something, and I kind of work backwards from there and write my sermon based upon what God has revealed to me. Well, this week, I hadn't written my sermon yet, and it was Christmas. So I was at my in-law's house, and I decided, you know, I can go over here and visit with the in-laws, or I can go write a sermon. Guess which one I chose. I decided to write my sermon, and the title of my sermon is Why? But I didn't have a good illustration. My thought was, why does God allow things to happen? Some things that I don't understand, some things that I don't grasp why He allows to happen. And I wrote my sermon, but I still didn't have a good illustration. Well, like I told you in the phone call, God has a sense of humor, doesn't He? Christmas night, we were driving home. Guess what happened to us? We hit a deer. Yeah. Candy's poor car. That car's going to spend more time in the shop than it does on the road. How many of you here have hit a deer before? You hunters need to go out there and shoot some more in my book. Be better shot or something. Oh, well, no poor little Bambi. Bambi didn't know what hit him. Literally. But I asked myself, why? Because the car, we can't drive the car now. Why did this happen? And it really kind of fell into the sermon for today. We all have things happen to us and we ask God why, don't we? We have things that happen in our lives that we don't understand. We tend to ask of God three different questions when these things happen. First off, we ask God, why is this happening? Why? We move on to say, why, God? Why are you putting me through this? Maybe we'll move on to the third question of why, what is the purpose in this, God? What is the purpose of this? Now, as I stand before you today and talk about running over a deer, I know that is nowhere near as serious as many of the things that you face is. I do not mean to belittle you, because I know some of the challenges and some of the things that you question are much more severe and much more life-altering than my example. But today, I want us to take a few minutes and look at that question that we ask. Why? Why, God? Why? I think that we can all agree on one thing to begin with, though. I think we can all agree that God is in charge, isn't He? Romans 8:28 says clearly, "We know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are called according to His purpose." You see how important those words are in there? All things work for good for those who are following His what? Purpose. There is no doubt in our minds that God is in control of this world and the things that happens in this world. But still, we ask the question when these things happen. Let's go back and look at these questions one by one. Probably the first one that we always ask is why? Why is this happening, God? Why is this happening? You had a situation like that this year? Asking God, why is this happening? How many of you in here can understand your spouse's mind? She can raise her hand. That's a simple question for her. Anybody in here understand your spouse's mind? No. Your spouse's mind is complex. And I don't care if you've been married 1 year or you've been married, 67 years. There's still things that your spouse can do that you cannot fathom, right? There are still times when your spouse will do something, you're like, what? Where did that come from? You cannot understand the mind of your spouse even if you have been with them for a long time. What makes us think that we can understand the mind of God then? God's mind is more complex than mine. God's mind is even more complex than my wife's mind. Can we know the ways of God? Can we? Some. God says, "My ways are not your ways." God is way smarter than we are, isn't He? We cannot know the ways of God. We can have ideas, we can have insights, but to know the mind of God is reserved for God and God alone. All that I can tell you without a doubt is that I may not know His ways, but I know that my God is great. I know that my God's plan is very well thought out. God knows what He's doing, doesn't He? God knows what He's doing. And when it comes to me and my plan, I'll be the first one to tell you, I ain't got a clue what I'm doing. How often can you plan out your life and know exactly what's going on and what will happen and how to react to it? Do you have foresight to know what the future holds for you? Do you? Man, y'all are quiet this morning. God knows what we face. God knows what our future holds. It is not for us to know what will happen. We cannot know what the future will hold because that belongs to God and God alone. And I have to ask you this question right here and now. If you had the ability to see your future, would you want to see it? I don't think I would either. I would worry too much about what was going to happen. So why do we ask God so often, why is this happening? Why do we ask God that? Is there any way that we could know the reason God has for the things that happen in our lives? We may have insights, we may have slivers, we may get a hold of a piece of it, but we cannot know the full plan of God this side of heaven. Yet we still ask God, why? Why? But let's progress from that. We ask God sometimes not only why is this happening, but we ask God, why are you putting me through this? Why are you putting me through this, God? Is it because you don't love me? Have you ever been so hurt? Have you ever been so broken? Has the world ever dumped on you so greatly that you had to ask that question? Do you still love me, God? God still loves you, doesn't He? Without a doubt, God loves you. You see, the world loves to try and play a trick on you. The world loves to try to hurt you and push you down to the point where you even doubt that God Himself loves you. The world likes to confuse you and make you think that God is not there and that He does not care for you anymore. But that is not the God that we serve, is it? How much does our God love us? Enough to come down here and live among us. What did we just celebrate? Christmas. God loves you enough to care about you. He loves you enough to be there for you. He loves you enough to come down here and to suffer the same things that you have suffered. God loves you more than you will know. Which makes me ask the question, is love about doing what is right, or is love doing what is wanted? Love is about doing what is right. I see today far too many children whose idea of love is getting their parents to give them whatever they want and to get them out of any trouble that they may get into. And unfortunately today there are many parents who believe that love is about making sure nothing bad ever happens to your child and making sure that any trouble your child may get into is quietly swept under the rug and pushed aside. Is it love to try and do that for your child? Is it love to take their mistakes and to push them away? Is it love to give them everything that they want? Okay, come on, it's simple. It's yes or no. I'll get y'all to get up to jumping jacks or something. Love is about doing what is right and not giving to that person everything that they want. True love is about discerning what that person needs and not what they want. It is a great disservice to give unto someone everything that they want. Because what are you teaching that person when you do that? You are teaching them that you are some great cosmic giver that only gives from what they want and does not give them anything that they truly need. There comes a time in a child's life when you have to say no. There comes a time in a child's life when you have to correct them. There comes a time in a child's life when you have to sit them down and spell out the responsibilities of their actions. And as I say that about a child, I would have to say that about us adults as well, wouldn't I? There comes a time in our lives when God has to sit us down and correct us. There comes a time in our adult lives when God has to say, you are wanting more than you're needing. To truly love someone is to prepare them for the future that they face. What's that old saying? Give a man a fish, feed him for a day, teach him to fish, he'll lie the rest of his life. Y'all, we have forgotten the responsibility that we have. We are to teach the next generation how to live. But unfortunately, instead of teaching the next generation how to live, we are living their lives for them. We are not teaching people how to fish. Instead, we are giving them fish day by day. We are not teaching them how to read the Scripture and to follow God. We are doing it for them. And unfortunately, we have come to expect God to provide for our needs and not correct us when we need the correction. We have come to expect God to treat us only with good and not to correct us when we fall away. As we read the Old Testament, how often does Israel fall away from God? All the time. And what happens to Israel when they fall away from God? They are punished. And eventually they come back to finding God and finding their relationship with Him again. Y'all, we as a nation have fallen away from God. We as a people have forgotten how important God is in our day-to-day lives. What is going to happen to us if we are not corrected of this mistake? It's a great song out there called History Repeating. And there are people that argue that there is no such thing as new events. It is all a matter of things that have happened in the past repeating themselves. Y'all, if we're not careful, we could wind up like Israel was. God's plan for you and God's plan for your future is large. He is preparing you for your future even now. When we ask ourselves, God, why are you putting me through this struggle? God, why are you putting me through this suffering? Do you think that God takes some great delight in seeing you hurt? No. When you face trials, when you face struggles, it is not to make God happy. It is to strengthen you. It is to encourage you. It is to build you up so that you can be what God has called you to be. Becoming a Christian is not about sitting back and having an easy life for the rest of your time on earth. Becoming a Christian and truly giving your life to Christ is about becoming what God wants you to become. And unless you go through trials, unless you go through stress, unless you go through tribulation, you will never grow beyond the point you are at right now. God knows what your future holds, and God wants you to be strong enough to face it when the time comes. Yes, you may be struggling now. Yes, you may have tribulations now. But these are not meant to harm you. They are meant to build you up so that you will be able to face whatever it is He has for you in the future. Why is God putting me through this? Because God has a plan for you. Why is this happening? I don't know. We can never understand the mind of God. Why is God putting you through this? To strengthen you. To help you be what you need to be. What is His purpose in putting you through this? This is the most tricky one of all. For you see, what is His purpose in this? Sometimes that question is answered almost immediately. Sometimes you can see how the hand of God works in your lives, maybe to influence you or maybe to influence someone else. Maybe this comes quickly, almost as quickly as the trial itself. But sometimes the meaning of it is not clear. Sometimes the understanding of why you had to go through this doesn't take moments, but takes years, maybe even decades. There are times when the reasonings of God are not as clear as we would like them to be, aren't there? But does it really matter why He's doing this? I'm going to let y'all in a little secret. Sometimes we may never know why God does the things that He does. It's not for us to know that, is it? Where in the Bible does it say we are to understand the ways and the will of God? Is that in Scripture? It does not matter if we know or not. What matters is that we are willing to serve even if we don't know what's going on. We are called to be servants. And even though Jesus calls us friends, a servant is one who does the will of his master whether he understands it or not. We who are called to be servants of God have been tasked to do what we know to be right, whether or not we feel like it, whether or not we understand it, whether or not it seems the thing to do. We are called to live our lives for Him and not for us. Too often we become conceited. Too often we become self-centered. And we think that this life is about us and what we can get out of it. We become selfish, and instead of praising God that we could have the troubles that we have, we become so self-concerned that we cry and complain because we are so blessed. Am I wrong? We're all doing pretty good, aren't we? I mean, I know that there's some problems going on. I know that we're having some issues, individuals. But ain't none of us scared for our lives, are they? I don't know if you can tell by looking at me, but ain't none of us truly hungry, are we? We have been blessed more than any other people on the face of this earth. Yet when strife, when trouble, when tribulation comes, we immediately fall back on our selfish, wanton ways and say, "Why, God? Why do I have to suffer like this?" Friends, there are people in the world today that cannot even begin to imagine the trouble that we're having because they cannot even imagine being as blessed as we are. Why do we have to suffer? Why does God put us through these things? I don't know. And I'm telling you right here and now, you don't need to know either. All you do need to know is that you need to serve God when it is good, and you need to serve God when times are bad. You need to serve Him when He is blessing you, and you need to serve Him even if it may seem that He has turned His back on you. Commitment is not about only being there when times are good. Commitment is about being there even when you can't see why. Why do these things happen? I don't know. But the God that I serve does know. And it is up to me to trust in Him that whatever He does and wherever He leads me, it is for my good and for my benefit so that I may serve Him even more than I have before. So today, my question to you is simple. Are you willing to trust in this God of who I speak? Even if the answer is not clear, even if you have asked and it has not been clarified for you, even if you ask and you still don't understand, are you, Christian, today still willing to serve God even if you cannot understand His ways and His works? Even if you do not know what is going on and cannot see God working in your life, are you still willing to serve Him with all that you have? I don't know if you are feeling blessed or depressed right now, but I do know that either way, you need to be willing to give unto Him all that you have. For friends, God wants all of us, doesn't He? He wants all that we are. But too often, we only give to Him when things are good. Christian, today my question to you is simple. Are you willing to trust even when you want to ask that question, why? Why is this happening? Why are you putting me through this? What is your purpose in this? Even when you feel like asking those questions, are you willing to trust that God is doing this for His purpose? And let's be honest. If it's done for His purpose, That's all that matters, isn't it? Trust does not require understanding. In fact, it flies completely in the face of understanding. God wants us to trust Him even though we cannot completely understand His ways. Simply because God says it, that should be good enough. There are so many people in this world, so many people who want a deeper explanation. They cannot believe in God because He cannot be easily codified. He cannot be easily understood. I want to tell you this right now. If God could be completely understood by me, I don't think I'd want to serve Him. Because I don't think He'd be nowhere near as powerful enough if I could completely understand Him. Today, I call upon you who maybe do not have a relationship with God. I call upon you maybe because you have never fully trusted in Him. Maybe you've never fully trusted in Him because you said, I could never understand Him. I've been at this game for a while. I've done a lot of reading, I've done a lot of studying, I've done a lot of praying. And I don't understand Him either. But I know that He loves me. And that's all I need to know. If today you are finally willing to admit that you do not understand and that you will never understand the ways of God, if you're finally willing to admit that you can trust in Him without seeing Him, if you are finally today willing to say that I will give my life unto Him, I would invite you, as we come to a time of invitation, if God has laid upon your heart that He is real and that He is trustworthy, I would invite you today to come forward and to make this statement that I believe in you even though I do not see you. That I believe in you and I believe in your love for me. If you have been struggling, if you have been hurting and you do not understand why God is putting you through this, I would invite you to come forward today. Don't ask God why. Ask Him for the strength to endure. For friends, whatever it is that you face, God has His reason. And if you give unto God and surrender yourself, even though you may be struggling now, God will bring you out of it. And you will be stronger and wiser for doing so. So today, as Reed comes and leads us in our time of invitation, I'll be standing down front and the altar will be open. If you are struggling with why, come forward and pray that God would give you the strength to trust. I pray that you would come down here and ask that God would give you the strength that you need to face whatever it is that is bringing you down. But most importantly of all, if you have never fully trusted Him, I ask that you would come down and speak to me. For my God loves you. And whether you realize it or not, He has plans for your good, plans to prosper you, plans for you to have a good future. If you would be willing to come forward and trust in Him. Reed?
Let's all stand. Take a hymn book and turn to page 312.